All right. Before I want to get started, I want to know something. Can everybody raise their hand if they consider themselves a developer? All right. Can now everybody raise their hand if they consider themselves an IT pro? Okay. Now can I see hands for people who have raised their hand at both questions? I'm with that last group. My name is Barbara Forbes, and I'm a consultant at SCCT, working in the Netherlands. I work with Azure, mostly, and I focus on automation, so infrastructure as code, PowerShell, and Azure DevOps. I run a blog about these subjects. It's called 4bes.nl. And I'm also on Twitter, if you want to find me, with BA4BAS. That's also my handle on GitHub and GitLab. So I think I should start with what actually is Azure DevOps. And to talk about that, I need to start with the question, what is DevOps? So we all know we're talking about the same thing. And I thought, well, how will I tell people what it is in two sentences? You know, I will look for the best answer of all times, Wikipedia. And this is the definition on Wikipedia. I want you to mention there's four sources out there citing we do not have a unique definition. We have no clue what the definition is. Well, that was very helpful. So I looked on and I found the definition that Microsoft is using. And it was created by Donovan Brown, who used to be on the Azure DevOps team. And he actually said that he took a very long time to come up with this definition. And I think a very important aspect of this definition is that it talks about delivering value. It's not delivering software or development or anything like that. It's delivering value, which means this process could be useful for an IT pro. To have an example about that, I want to get in a bit more concrete with the DevOps circle. There's a lot of versions out there on the internet. You probably don't know this one because I have made it myself. Well, I use someone else's templates and change the colors to my liking. And I want to consider this circle and an example of a typical system administration task. Let's say you have a server that's running 2008. So Windows 2008 support is ending. We need to do an upgrade. And we're going to do a side-by-side upgrade to server 2019. Now, the first step you would take is plan the activity. So you consider how many engineers do I need? Who will be able to do this? Do I have all the knowledge I need, or do people need to read into stuff? Who will be affected by this change? Do I need a maintenance window? Do I need to work with other teams for that? Stuff like that. So everything will be planned, and you think about what needs to be done, what the downtime is, and who the stakeholders are. And after you've done it, you get to the step code, which you could also translate to create. And in the step create, you actually put down the server, you could deploy a VM to Azure, to AWS, to your on-prem environment, maybe install an OS or choose an OS, take care of antivirus solutions, take care of the backup, the Windows features that you need, software, anything. You could create the whole thing so it could run in production if you'd like. Now the build step, this is a bit difficult to translate because this is where you compile the software. So it's difficult to translate to an IT pro step, but you can combine it with the testing step, and then you can use it for the migration we talked about. Because at the testing stage, you're going to see, will this server do what I expect it to do? Maybe you have pilot users testing the stuff for you. Maybe you try a first bit of migration to see if it works. So you test if everything will do what you expect it to do. And after all is said and done, and at this stage you also test, is everyone still okay with the maintenance window? Does everybody still know what we're doing? Is the service desk up to date of this change coming up? And maybe support tickets are coming in. And if it's all clear, then you move on to the release step. So you do the actual migration, and you deploy a new server, and change DNS records, stuff like that. And now we start operating, the op step. So It's in production, it's happening, and people are going to work with it and going to notice all the mistakes that you didn't fix in the testing stage because you didn't think of them, because they are going to be there. So you can start operating, you start monitoring, and see if the server does what it's supposed to be doing. At this point, actually, there might be something new coming up with this server. Maybe this is a file server, and people are complaining there's not enough room, so you want to add some disks or expand some disks. And you could start a circle again. At this point, the server's become a project where you say the monitoring shows us we need to do another change, and we're going to start the planning stage. And here we have used the DevOps circle for a typical system administrator task. Now, this is quite a big example. This can also work for quite small day-to-day tasks. This could work for adding a bit of functionality to a PowerShell script or deploying an extra VM if you've got a large environment. So this is just an example of how you can use the DevOps circle as an IT pro. So with this, let's take it back to Azure DevOps. This is a tooling you can use to help with this process and make tooling available like the plan step. And I'm going to talk through this in the time I have now. And I actually started using Azure DevOps when I was working in a team as an IT pro. We were moving to the cloud, but we also had an on-prem environment. And our issue was that we had a lot of non-standard changes. Because the incidents were all right, and a lot of the standard changes, we had automated them because we love to automate stuff. But the standard changes were, the non-standard changes, we were running an Excel sheet to keep track of them. Awesome. So we needed something better, and we started using Azure DevOps step by step, starting with the boards, and later our complete process got into the Azure DevOps tooling. So I'm going to follow the steps of the circle now. And this is a project within Azure DevOps. And here you can see some tools that are like that circle. So the boards is for the planning. The repos are for the code. And in the pipelines, you can build, test, and release. There are some other steps available as well, but I'm not going to consider them in this talk because I don't think if we look at the relevance for the IT pro, these are the ones that are most important in my opinion. Now what happens in Azure DevOps is you have an organization. And within an organization, you have projects. And within the projects, you have teams. So those are some boundaries in there. And you can build a complete company on one project if that's what you like. And there's actually a lot of documentation about how you make choices in the division, in projects or teams. And you can create your own organization as well. Even with this user account, you can create an own organization. So you're saying probably, how can I get me one of those? And I want to show you with a quick demo here. So this is dev.azure.com. You can also just put it in your favorite search engine. Azure DevOps, you will get there. And the first button you will see is Start Free or Start Free with GitHub. And I'm going to use Start Free. And you get the typical sign-in screen with Azure. And I will show you can here sign in with an Office 365 account, with a personal Microsoft account, soft account, or your GitHub account. And I use the demo account here to sign in. And the first question it asks me is, where am I located? And let me just make this a bit bigger. Now, my company is in the Netherlands. Well, this is my personal tenant, but it's in the Netherlands. And I don't need information because I'm getting it already. I click on True. And it's building my Azure DevOps creation. So this is free. There's nothing going on. No credit cards, no issues, stuff like that. And here I have a project. It's there already. You see my company is called Demo0916, not an ideal name, but I can create a new one if I'd like. And I can create a project in here and choose whether it's private or public. And this is a bit like a Git repository. So public really means the whole world will be able to see it. And when it's private, it's just for your company, and you can use permissions and stuff like that. So create a project. And there it is. That's how fast it is. So that's all you need to do. You can do it in your lunch break. You can do it in your coffee break. It's really easy to set up in this. And to talk about licensing a bit, for the licensing, you can get very far with free licenses. You get 5 user accounts for free. So if you're a small team, you can just get started. Partnership licensing is available, and there's open sourcing licensing available. But there's a lot of possibilities without having to pay for anything or providing credit card information. So that shouldn't be keeping you. But now let's see what we get to do. The first step we talked about was the plan step. We need to plan a change or an incident. It would be nice if you could plan an incident, whatever. We get the boards available. And I say it's a to-do list, except that it's not, because I think a lot of people will get angry if I compare Agile with just a to-do list. So I say it's not a to-do list, except that it is. I use it as a to-do list mostly. And the tooling we have here, the biggest division you will see, that the work items are all the items that need to be done. And in the boards and the sprints, you see all the items that are relevant for this period of time that you're working in. This could be a week, this could be 2 weeks, could be a month, whatever is your choosing, your choose. And in the backlogs, you see all the items that are all the, will be done at a later period, so they're not that relevant right now. So as I said, this is built on an agile workflow. And this is like a process for planning all your teamwork, which finds its way in software development. And there's a whole theory behind it, like it's important to respond to change, more important than following a plan. Individuals are more important than processes, stuff like that. I could fill a whole talk about that, but I wouldn't be very good at it. So I'm not going to do that. But it's good to think about that this is the theory that it is behind the boards and the planning. And the thing is, you can do it as simple as you like. This is actually it's preview or just out of preview. You can't use this on existing projects. This is for new projects. You can use this workflow, which is basic, and it's to do, doing, and done. So this makes it the easiest way, the most simple way to get started with it. And you get these columns with these tasks, and this will give you a visual representation of what is happening and what everyone is doing in your team. And you see in an overview like this, you only need the middle one, so you get a very clear view of what's going on. And this is the point where you can start thinking about what is your use case. Maybe you want this for standard changes because you find it easier to keep track of them. Probably you're working with incidents as well, and you can't plan those, but I remember we did add them into the board if there was a big incident, so we knew what someone was up to. And I want to show you a bit more of the possibilities that are available. There's going to be a lot going on, but this is just to give you a view of what your options are. So this is my personal board. And yes, I run my life on this board. And I have put a filter in there because my personal items are on there and it's not of your business. But these are the technical stuff that I'm doing outside of work. So I have a blog, I have a PowerShell module that I have to maintain. I have talks going on, things to plan, and this is how I keep track of my life. And you can see the columns here, and on the left you have the column new, and these are items that we will not be doing these 2 weeks. So this is my backlog, the Dutch G is coming through. That's my backlog, and I don't care about it now, so I can hide that column and give myself a bit of peace of mind. Next to that, I created my own column. It's called on hold, and these are items that I do need to keep track of, but I can't take an action. For this one, for example, I'm waiting for an hotel confirmation. I can't do anything, but I do want to know it's there. Next to that is my active items and my resolved items. And active items are things that I should be doing are doing now. And when I'm done with something, I can drag it to resolved and pat myself on the back and be happy that something is done. And when my week is over or my 2 weeks are over, I drag it to the closed column. And it's not that important anymore. And it's good to know that there was history, but I can close this one as well. So I have a clear view now of all the things there are active, and the color coordination, I did that because I really like the visual aspect and I'm color focused. So I got some tags on everything so I see what category is going on. And here I have an example. I had to do a release in my module that's in the PowerShell gallery because an issue had come up. And I can click it and I have a work item with all these possibilities of things I can do with it. I can add a description, I can add acceptance criteria about when will it be done. I have can have a discussion with all the other people are using this board, but I haven't had my husband on board yet. And I can see the history of what's going on. So if you have a big team, you can see who has done something with the change and who has worked on something, who has pulled it back or made a decision about it. So the auditing stuff is nice as well about that. And for this particular one, I actually have already released this. So this I can drag this to resolved and pat myself on the back and be happy that it's done and move on to all the other stuff that's on my to-do list. And now the one at the top of this column is give the talk, and that's talking about this one. I would say that's pretty active at this point. And what I can do is add tasks to it. So I can have subtasks under there where I can put a check mark on it when it's done. So let's say the first task was the introduction. Then I had a demo about how to create your organization. And I had a thing about the boards and a demo about the boards. I'm not going to tell the rest. We need some surprises here. And I can tick those, ready with those. Those are done. And I can keep track of a bigger item and see it like that. And if it's done and all these items are tracked, I can drag it to the resolved column. Can't do this for this one, not ready yet. So this is a bit of an example of how you can use the board. If you're interested in this as well, you think, well, I want to get into this, start small with it. You don't have to make use of every solution that's available. We actually did that when we first discovered the settings. And as I said, I'm color orientated, so I had it completely filled with all these different colors, and my colleagues begged me to turn it back because it was like Eastern there. It was terrible. So be critical of how it works. Just try something out and discuss with your team. How do you feel about it? Does it still make us happy? Is this working for us? And if it's not, change it. Don't think to yourself, well, we should work in some way because Agile says so. No, work how it works for you. And start with a personal board, really, really. It made my personal life so much easier to keep track of everything and get your family on board. If you want to have some project coming up, getting ready for a move or something, get your family in there. So we have planned our change. At this time, we're going to use the code step. And we're going to use the code for an IT pro. And this is a Git provider, repos. So it's like GitHub, GitLab, stuff like that. They have their own provider where you can use Git to sync your code and work together on the code. So what kind of code are we talking about if we're an IT pro? Of course, there's PowerShell. And I can assume, I think everyone here is using PowerShell. And if you're not, you should. It's awesome. We also have infrastructure as code. This is Terraform and ARM templates because it's the one that I have used in the past. This one as well, we want to ignore it, it's there. Are there people here still using login scripts in their environment? It's reality, and if you have it in your environment, you can use the repos to keep track of all those files. So this is what it would look like. And this is an example for me that I made to show you how it looks in the web interface. You can interact with it at this point You can show the preview. You have this preview of Markdown, and it shows emojis, which make it so much better. You can see the history of the file. You can edit the file, rename it. So all the stuff you would expect to be able to do with a Git file, you can do in here. And moving on, you've got some security options in here. You can protect branches, like say you can't push to master, or people should review it, and should specific people review it. You can lock a branch if you're using it and everybody else should not touch it. And you can see exactly where your code has changed. And this is where your security officer gets really happy, because you have an auditable track of what's going on. And if a code does something bad in production, here you can see at what point did what happen and who was involved with it. But another use case that I want to point out is documentation. This gives you an opportunity to keep your documents at the same track as your code. And the most obvious file is Markdown. But you can put Office files in here as well. And I did that when I was working for a team that just started using Git. And before that, we had all our PowerShell scripts on SharePoint, which is not the best place if you have something like this. And we had a doc file at every script, which explained how to use it. Now, that's not really something you want, but that was the reality. And if I had to change all those doc files at that point, the change would take a whole lot of time. So I just put them all in the GitHub and put it on the board to change at a later time. And you can go quite far with that. It really isn't meant for it. I wouldn't recommend it. But if you want to, you can use it for that. There are limits, though, and I have tried to push them because I wanted to see where the limit was. And this is my repo where I keep track of this talk. And the PowerPoint is not there anymore because it broke it. The file got too big. So there are limits, and this is not something I would recommend. But if this is what you need to get you started with Git with your team, do it. It works. So getting back to getting started with that, I think when you start working repos, you start working Git. And it's very important that everyone in your team is excited about using Git. And to allow them to get excited, you need to allow them time to get used to it. Because I have about three different occasions where people try to teach me Git. And they threw all these commands at me, and there was so much going on that I had given up before I had started. So keep it easy, keep it tiny, and allow people to get used to it and see why it's a great tool to use. And the policies I do want to mention, be careful about your workflow. You need to understand security, but you also need to understand the workflow. And if you make it too hard for people to get involved, they will not be involved, or they're going to start working around you, and you don't want that last one. So we have written our code in the repo. Oh, I must mention, if you're already using GitHub, you can actually use GitHub for all the other aspects of Azure DevOps. So that's up to you. There is a complete connection there. But we've completed the code, and we're moving on to the building and test phase, which I will take into one. As I said, build is not really a part of the IT pro workflow. So to consider this, I need to consider a CI/CD pipeline. And I'll walk back just a bit. What the pipeline does is automate these tasks for you: the build, test, and release. You can put them in a pipeline. A pipeline is considered scripts. You have scripts that are running on an agent and performing tasks for you. So they will probably be triggered automatically, or you can do that manually, and they will do all these tests automatically for you. So they do the testing and the releasing for you. And in Azure DevOps, these are YAML files, but you also get a visual editor available. If you're not familiar with YAML, what it gives you are all these tasks that you can use. And you can use the visual editor, and it will actually show you the YAML that it generates. So it's a great way to learn about YAML. And if you think about testing for an IT pro, you can think about pester testing for your PowerShell scripts. But there are also tasks available for ARM templates where you can do a validation if your template is correct. If you have modules, you can compile them here. You can compile Azure resources, stuff like that. There's a whole lot of possibilities, and this is one I want to show you for infrastructure as code. These are standard tasks I just filled in. This is my template. These are the parameters, and it tests for me if it is a correct one. The tasks, there are a bunch of them available by default. And there's a marketplace with extensions that people have created for stuff like Terraform or the things that are available at this conference, like Chef, Octopus, and Chocolaty. So there's a lot of options there, and a lot of times where you can create something yourself. And what you end up with is a nice overview. Well, you can end up with a nice overview of how your tests are doing and what's happening. And here you see my commit was fix a typo, and there's 16 failed tasks on that. And stuff like this happens, but you see I have 166 automated tests running on my scripts to make sure the code quality is what I expect it to be. So this can be very useful. Now about this start, this part, so the build and test, this is hard to get into because it's a bit fake. And it's hard to see what it will return on investment for you, what your profit is. And the learning curve can be a bit steep, but you can work in small steps. And the return on investment is huge, because I have used the automated testing on my PowerShell module. And since I did that, I can do the changes so much faster, because I will know that everything will run as it should. So it's really helpful, and I really encourage you to get into it if you haven't already. And don't stop learning, because there's a lot of is going on, a lot of different functionalities, and there's so much getting new stuff being added like daily. It takes a bit of time to get into, but it can really be helpful. And start with the classical editor and start with one or two tasks. Don't make it too hard when you get started. First, see the structure and the rest will follow. So we have built the code, we have tested our code. Now it's time to release the code. We're actually going to deploy something. And this is also part of the pipeline. And I want to show you an example, but this is a bit of cheating because this is in a preview feature called multi-stage releases. And it was when I was preparing for this talk that I realized this is in preview. Because since I have activated, I have not looked back. And I had kind of forgotten that release is actually a separate step. But I use this because this is a nice overview of what's happening in a pipeline. And this is a PowerShell module that I created and deployed to the PowerShell gallery. And you can see here I have the build steps, and I use Windows agents, so agents that are provided by Azure DevOps. And I can test my scripts on Windows, Mac OS, and Linux. And I don't have those OSs myself, so I now know that my PowerShell core scripts are actually working, which is really nice. For everyone who's paying really good attention, see the Windows task is taking a whole lot longer. And it's saying, you see Windows is slow. No, the Windows task is actually doing some extra tests, because this is a PowerShell module that needs to interact with Azure. And it actually does. It's, the Windows task interacts with Azure to see if the module would work. So it's not because Windows is slow. It's doing more stuff. And I have the build, and after that, I have to deploy. And this is a script that deploys this to the gallery. So if I push to master, that's the code that will be in the gallery. So I have a very consistent scripting environment that way. Now I realize not everybody has a module in the gallery. You can use this for source control to Azure. You have a repository, and you can say in an Azure automation account, I want all the runbooks to be like the PowerShell scripts in that repository. And you can do it with GitHub as well, but also with Azure DevOps. You don't even need a pipeline, really. You set this up in Azure. And you now know you have consistent scripting with the auditing and the history in your Azure Automation account. And I know some of you are thinking, well, it's all fun with all that cloud stuff. But I've got an on-prem environment, and I've got a scripting server somewhere that's doing all my scripting and scheduled tasks. You can use for that as well, because you can create your own agent. You can create a local agent, put it on a domain joint machine, and have that agent do the tasks for you. So here I have a copy files task that would copy my repository files to the scripting server where all the scripts are living and doing their stuff. It's quite easy to install the agent. It's a bit of PowerShell. One thing that you need to be careful about is permissions. What account are you using and what permissions does it have? You can, of course, make the account domain admin, but wouldn't consider that the best practice. And want to show you something. Because what I want to show you is something that I created that makes use of some awesome features for the Azure DevOps pipeline, I think. Because I work a lot with infrastructure, and a use case I had was the point where I was working a lot with identity stuff, and I often wanted to test something real quickly, like an Azure AD Connect agent or something like that. So I wanted to perform a quick test, and if I did, I needed a domain controller and a few domain joint VMs and maybe some non-domain joint VMs. So I went to work with ARM templates, PowerShell, and a whole lot of automation in between. And I created something, and I want to show you the... These are my pipelines, so you can have more than one pipeline when working in a project. I have a lot going on. This is my testing repository, and there is actually one running, and I have no clue why. I'll get into that later. But here you can see some examples of the pipelines that I have created and have failed miserably, because this is my testing environment. And I want to show you this one, because my subject was to create a one-click environment. And what I can do here is run pipeline, and I make use of the variables that I have available. And the one on top that you see is allow RDP, and I can fill in my external IP address, and that will be the only IP address that is able to connect with the VMs that I will be deploying through the network security group. And I have an auto-delete tag because I have an Azure function running that destroys everything that has this tag at the end of the night. I can put it to false if I still need it. And here I have client deploy and DMZ deploy and DC deploy. And here I can fill in the numbers of VMs that I need. So I can just say, well, I need to do some testing here, so I want one... domain control, domain joint VM. It will deploy the domain controller as well for me. And for this test, I also need a non-domain joint VM, both with the Windows environment. And I can choose the domain name, and it all gets back to the desired state configuration files and the ARM template files, where it uses these variables. I can use one that's globally used, but I don't want that. I want the local one. I can put a prefix in there for the VMs and for the resource groups to provide a name for them. Let's do that. So I make use of the fact that I can change these while running the pipeline. And as you did see, they did have a default value, so I don't need to do it. And I click run now. And this starts deploying. And with the domain controller, that the desired state configuration takes a bit of time. But in 45 minutes, I would have a complete environment there, ready to use and securely, because it's only I am able to see them. And I make use of the stages here, so I have to deploy a network security group. I need that for whatever I'm deploying, so I deploy it first. And these can run side by side. They're not dependent on each other. So I could use the dependency if there is some dependency there. So I know all these resources are dependent on the network security group, but they are not dependent on each other. So I can structure the pipelines which way they work for me. And of course, the build step is in front, which does the testing if my templates might have changed whatsoever. And it will fail the build if it's not working. So it will stop the build if something is going on there. So that's one use case. There's a lot of use cases for those release pipelines. If you get into this, do start with the visual editor and use the show YAML button that's on every step that you can use, because it helps you to learn the YAML, but it also helps you to visualize what's actually happening. Make use of those variables, and also there's secure variables available there. So you can tick a box and the variable will not be visible for anyone running the pipeline. You can actually also use Azure Key Vault for your secure variables. But if you keep them here, people will be able to use them, but they will not see what the value is. And try out your structures, try out your different options, and find one that works. I'm gonna take a look at the timer. I'm a bit fast, but I don't think they will mind. So we've gone full circle. We haven't done the operation monitoring, because that's where we get our inspiration to start new planning and start circle again. But every circle has found its place in system administrator tasks. Now, to put this all together, if you want to get started with this, one thing that's incredibly important is to involve your team. Don't just tell them that you're going to do this, but see, get them all involved in why you're doing stuff and what you are doing, what elements you're choosing to use and what not. You can have them all create their own organization to fool around with it a bit if they want to. That's fine, although you do need to watch out for shadow IT in some ways. But that's why it's important to involve them and make sure you keep communicating. And don't think this is just your colleagues. This is also your team manager or scrum master or whoever is mentioning you. This can be your security officer. This can be whoever is responsible for the budget. Tell them why you are using this workflow and why it will benefit the team greatly. And try and adapt, so try something. Don't wait till you know enough about it to feel sufficient to start with it. Now just go. Start with it, and whatever doesn't work, adapt with it. And make it work for you. And there's my bridge. Make Azure DevOps work for you, because a lot of people might tell you how you should use it, and there's a lot of documentation. But a lot of that is aimed at software development. And you're not a software developer, you're an IT pro in this case, or maybe you just need to do system administration tasks. And if it works for you, you're doing it right. And if you're not doing it right and you think you're doing it right, you will find out one time or another. So don't worry too much about, well, I should be doing this, but this works better for me. Then do that one. Make it work for you. So, you want to get into this. How do you start? Well, I've shown you how to create an organization that it takes about 2 minutes. So, you can do it, wait for the other sessions, do it in the lunch. Lunch break, you can do this easily. Just go to dev.azure.com, start for free, start with your GitHub, start however you like. The Microsoft docs are an amazing resource for Azure DevOps. They have a lot of pages that are talking about how you do stuff, with really broken down how you do the different steps, but also a lot about the why and the how. So the why would you use DevOps? How do you decide what structure to use? Why do you use Agile or Basic or Scrum structure? How do you choose how to use projects or teams or stuff like that? So there's a lot of pages that are really readable, so I really would recommend them. I want to mention Microsoft Learn. If you don't know this resource and you have something to do with Azure, get into it anyway, because it's really fun. It's like sandboxes that gets available for you. So there's some theory going on, and then it's, you know, now you try it yourself. And they released it sometime last year, and they now actually have a DevOps learning path and an Azure DevOps learning path. So the DevOps path is about what is DevOps, and the Azure DevOps path is about how to use Azure DevOps. It is aimed at software development, but the translation is quite easily made, so I would recommend it. And I'm going to shamelessly promote myself a bit, because I focused on this for my blog a bit, and it's for bes.nl. I have a lot of step-by-step guides on how to create your own pipeline and stuff like that, aimed at infrastructure and PowerShell. So that's it for me. If you have any questions whatsoever, want to know anything, you can always message me on Twitter. I always find it fun if people talk with me. If you want to ask me anything in person, I'll be here walking around. Don't hesitate to ask me anything. And I really want to thank you for your time and hope you enjoy your day.